Who are you?
Who are you? What I do does not make me who I am. The world and the signs of the times and the circumstances doesn't determine the church's future. God determines the church's future. In the scripture, we are demanded to examine fruit. We are not supposed to judge intentions or someone's heart. Do you give people a new chance? Over and over and over. You forgive like this because forgiveness is granted, trust is earned. Why is God thinking sin's bad? Because it separates you from Him and it hurts and destroys your life.
Welcome you to Crossfire Television. God is doing some great things, and I want to invite you into today's program. The message is called, Who Am I? And I believe that God is trying to speak to each and every one of us to develop who we are in Christ, to understand who God has deemed us to be, who He has ordained us to be. And I want to encourage you to watch today's program. I also want to take just a moment, invite you to become more involved in finding out what Crossfire is all about. www.mycrossfire.com, www.mycrossfire.com, and it will let you know a lot more about what is happening in the church, what's happening around the world through missions, what God is doing in this church to bring forth His purposes and His glory as we come together and unify as the body of Christ. You see, alone we can't do anything apart from God and apart from one another. But when we come into unity, when we begin to care about each other, when we begin to put our efforts together and let the power of God through unity bring forth miracles. And God is doing miracles today. And I am excited to be a part of that. So I want to encourage you to check out what Crossfire is about. If you do not belong to a church or haven't went in a long time and you've been unconnected with the body of Christ, you happen to live in the Eugene Springfield area, we would love to have you come and visit Crossfire Family Worship Center. It is an incredible church where God is really doing great things. We have watched our church grow 3 times its size just within the last year. It is amazing. It is amazing what God's doing. As people are coming to Christ, they're being discipled, multiple classes, different trainings and discipleship times. God is doing great things, and it's an enjoyable time to spend together. Every Sunday morning at 9 and at 10:30, we have 2 services where you can come and enjoy the presence of the Lord, as well as things that happen virtually every night of the week in one ministry or another here at Crossfire. So check out the calendar online. Give us a call if you have any questions. We'd like to know more about Crossfire at 541-686-5433. Check out Who Am I? We all need to know who we are in Christ.
You can also watch or listen to Crossfire online. Just go to www.mycrossfire.com and you can view one of our latest television broadcasts. You can also subscribe to our weekly podcast by clicking on the subscription icons. Keep up with our latest events and all that God is doing with Crossfire. Don't miss out on our weekly messages and podcasts.
Who are you? You know, many years ago, I went to see a psychologist. Because there were some who thought I was nuts. They were right. I mean, they were right. I was crazy and still am. But so I had to go to a psychologist to determine whether or not I was crazy or not. And so I did. I went and visited this psychologist. And the first hour
was an interesting hour. And, you know, it's a little scary when they, you know, that they trying to figure out if you're crazy or not. And so I'm, you know, really expecting this guy to be able to give me some real information, you know, and then he's a psychologist. I'd like to hear what he's got to say. So he asked me, so tell me who you are. And so I began to tell him who I was. Now, I want to tell you, this wasn't like 25 years ago. This wasn't when I was a drug addict or into alcohol. This wasn't any of those times. This was when I was a pastor. It's about 10 years ago. And so I told him, you know, who I was. And tried to tell him a little what I thought he wanted to hear. So after an hour of every time I would tell him, he'd say, that's not who you are, that's what you do. So could you tell me who you are? So then I would explain who I was, and his response would be, that's not really who you are, that's what you do. Could you please tell me who you are? And all the time, he's just scribbling away. I'm seeing my life flash before my eyes. I mean, I've got visions of a padded room. And you know, the bummer about this thing was, is it wasn't only an hour of my time, it was $120 of my money, you know? And I had to come back again. So the next time I show up, you're never going to guess the question. Could you just tell me who you are? I'm like, are you kidding me? Not again. I am not doing this again. He goes, I just would like to know who you are. So I began to tell him who I was again, and he goes, And I said, I'll be honest with you. You're making me want to just like jump across the table here and throttle you. You know what I mean? And he goes, really? How does that make you feel? Oh, I got a new question. Another $120 and I got a new question. How does that make you feel? And I'd say, well, you know, Well, how does that make you feel? Well, I feel like I'm wasting my time. Really? What is wasting your time? How does that make you feel? After the third time, he wrote me off a clean bill of health, and I am sane to some degree anyway. And $360 later, I was able to get my my diploma, yeah, of sanity. I went to visit a guy, a friend of mine, in the Johnson unit. It was a pastor. Went to the Johnson unit. And so I went to visit him. And there's all kinds of people, crazy, you know, I'm around daily. So, but they're not all my children. And had to get a jab. So anyway, I went to visit this guy, and he said, listen, you're in a lot of trouble. I said, really? He said, yeah, I am too. This is bad. I'm never getting out. I said, well, what do you mean? He goes, look. And he slides the little paper across the table. And I start reading it. They're not letting me out of here, man. And you're never getting out of here. I started reading down this list, and there were things like, you know, do you ever hear voices? Yeah. Do you think you hear from God? Yeah. Do you believe that you can speak in another language that you've never learned? Yeah. And then, no joke, right on the paper it said, do you speak in other tongues? Yeah! What am I supposed to do? Deny it? I mean, come on. I can't be much of a pastor if I'm denying all that. I just turned the tape paper around. I slid it across the desk. I said, man, you're sorry. You're in a lot of trouble. I ain't ever going to get where they have to make me sign that because I'm done for, you know? Folks, who are you? I mean, really, that's what today I really want you to leave and understand. Who are you? I'm going to bust through this message the fastest I possibly can, but it will change your life in the next few minutes if you'll listen. I encourage you to get a pen and paper out. I encourage you to write down some stuff. I encourage you to let God speak to you as fast as I can get it out. I am not going to back everything up with a ton of scripture because I don't have time. I'll give you the scriptures. You go look them up and read them. Okay? So I'm just setting the stage right off the bat. But I want to read something to set a precedence for where we're at. To advance into kingdom living, last week I shared the vision for this coming year. I believe that we are advancing, moving forward, increasing into kingdom living, into a brand new way of living that some of us have never experienced. And as a congregation, I think we're going to see some changes. In fact, I have never been more excited about a year of life and ministry than I am this year. I think we're going to see the most incredible, incredible year that we've ever had. But I believe that God is having us increase into kingdom living, something beyond just surviving, just living a day-to-day life. I believe that our lives are going to become so exciting. Now listen, you hear a lot of doom and gloom about the economy. You hear a lot of doom and gloom about the situations, the future, end times. I want to tell you, when you hear those doom and gloom guys, just, you know what, just go to them or something. I mean, and they're probably on the radio anyway or on TV, but if they're right in your face, you can be nice about it. And then when you walk away, be like, you know, because I want to tell you something. It ain't doom and it ain't gloom. No, give me right. For the world, they're right. But for us, they're not right. Because the world and the signs of the times and the circumstances doesn't determine the church's future. God determines the church's future. And what is the church's future? By the way, who is the church? Who? No, we are not. I am. We aren't. I am. See, it can't be some, oh, yeah, we as a group when we come together. No, I'm the church when we're not together. I'm the church all the time. I'm God's chosen. And my future is not determined or hung on what's going on outside these walls. You know what my determination of my future is who Jesus Christ is. Now, listen, who am I? What I do does not make me who I am. Now listen, I want you to really get this. This is something you ought to write down, and you ought to read it on a regular basis so you can figure this out in your life. What I do does not make me who I am. What I am makes me do what I do. You say, you're just turning some words around. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. You see, if I'm a tree and I'm bearing fruit, I may bear bad fruit. Right? I can't just change my fruit. I change the nutrients of the soil, of the root system has to change. You can't just glue new fruit onto my limbs. You've got to change something down in the root system. You've got to begin to change the root system. And we've got a lot of Christians out there putting a bunch of fake fruit. Have you ever eaten from a good Christian's fruit? They're plastic. I mean, you ever been sold on like, okay, come on, let's be real. How many of you guys, you know, the waiter leaves the little tray of the pie and you think to yourself, no one's looking, I just want to taste that right there. Am I the only one? Uh-oh. That's not good. So here's the deal. If you reach out and you taste that little bit of, when you reach out and it's like, oh man, it's plastic. That ain't cool. But you know what's worse? When someone sees you do it and that waiter comes up and goes, that thing was made this morning, man, you're going to get sick. That's a bad deal right there. But reality is, folks, we got plastic fruit. We're gluing on our limbs trying to act like we've got fruit. I want to give you an example. There were healing ministries in this nation, tent revivals, healing ministries. God anointed them. God blessed them. Incredible healings were happening. They were taking babies and kicking cancer out of them. I'm not joking. You got to hear from God to take a baby and kick it against the wall. That's going to tick off some mamas if that baby, when it hits the ground, ain't healed. Right? You know, you slap somebody or punch them in the gut because they got cancer. I mean, the fight's on, man. And there was weird stuff like that happening. Cancer's healed. Boom. People coming up out of wheelchairs. Boom. And you know what? God had a moving revival of healing. But you know what? Men, man, they built great ministries on healing revivals. And then you know what? God began to remove his hand for a time, not from healing overall, just from these huge pushes of revival healings. God began to remove his hand. And do you know what the ministries did? No, they didn't close nothing down. They just kept going. They just didn't have the big miracles anymore. They just inflated what really was going on. They just made it sound like it was bigger and better than it really was. Folks, there was false fruit being put on trees. See, we do know and we test fruit. Did you know I'm a Christian. I'm not supposed to judge. Those Christians, they're not supposed to judge. Well, read your Bible. You are supposed to judge. In fact, you have to judge. I'm not supposed to judge. Is there anybody here who's a meth addict? Would you like to, you know, maybe my daughter would like to marry you? You know, she's a beautiful, wonderful lady of God. Maybe she'll get you saved. If you're addicted to meth and don't have a job and don't plan on getting one, could you bring you and your tooth up here? And sorry, I get out of control sometimes. This would be one of those times. My daughter's going to marry you. I'm not belittling. Listen, I'm not belittling anyone that is going through a tough time. I'm telling you something. You ain't going to get next to my daughter unless you're living right. And if you are, I'm going to take that tooth out. Okay? Now, here's the reality is, folks, my daughter means a lot to me enough that I am going to examine the fruit. In the scripture, we are demanded to examine fruit. We're not supposed to judge intentions or someone's heart. I don't know what your heart is, and I don't know what your intentions are, but your fruit is pretty obvious. Now, do we forgive people? Man, I mean, I wish I could read all the scriptures I got. Yes, you better. Do you give people a new chance? Over and over and over. You forgive like this because forgiveness is granted, trust is earned. You gotta learn that. I haven't got into my message. So, Exodus 3:1. Moses is tending his flock and he goes out and he is in an area where he's went away. And he sees the bush is burning. Now, when he sees this bush burning, he says he turns to look at it. It's kind of weird because he's like, I'm going to turn and look at this. You know, you can tell he's writing. It was at the beginning of the the writing stage, I guess. And so, but he's turning to look at this burning bush, right? Folks, can I just tell you that God is trying to get your attention? The burning bush was all about, God could do a lot of things, but here's the problem. Moses was going about his way, tending the sheep, doing something normal every day. He's out there hanging out, doing his stuff, and something needed to get his attention. Can I tell you that something needs to get our attention? And God would like it if you would just give it to him. Every day. All the time. But you know what? We got problems and stuff, and we don't have faith. And because we don't have faith, we don't listen to him. When you begin to grow in your faith, you begin to trust God. It means you give him your attention and you begin to act on what he said. So the first step is God wants to get your attention. If you're waiting for God to get your attention, you may not like how he does it. It's not always a nice burning bush. Sometimes it's a burning house. Sometimes it's a burning hair. Some of you don't know the story. Someday I'll tell you. So everybody be asking, how'd your hair burn off? It didn't. All right. So number one, God's got to get our attention. Secondly, in verse 4, it says, so when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. So the second thing is, God began to call him by name. Can I tell you, God, he can call you by name all day long, but if you're not listening, you're not in a position to hear, and then you know what? You can't receive. And God is always after you. But when you've got so many problems and so many things, even when you call out to God, you can't really hear him until you begin to focus in and say, God, I want your attention, and you give it to him on a regular basis. Otherwise, you're going to live from catastrophe to catastrophe to catastrophe. And God will get your attention a little here and a little there, but your life will never be changed. Why? Because you're dealing with just fruit, exterior things, and not ever getting to what is really inside. See, we want to change what we do. God wants to change who we are. And how does he change who we are? Well, I want to tell you something. It's not going to Hannah's house for a day. It ain't coming to church once and walking up here and say, Jesus, come into my heart. Am I belittling salvation? Absolutely not. But that isn't going to change your life and future. Whoa! It isn't alone. That's a beginning. That's where life starts. If you think that's where it ends, if you think it's a quick fix and you come up, maybe, oh, you know, Pastor, I love these people. Pastor, I just can't wait. I know when I hit the water during baptism, my whole life will change. What do you think I tell them? I doubt that seriously. You say, do you not believe in the power of God? Oh, no. I bank on the power of God. I believe in salvation. I believe baptism changes your life. But I want to tell you something. It isn't that. It isn't water that does it. It isn't saying a mantra that does it. It's when you look inside and say, God, I need your help to show me who I really am. And then you begin to say, God, I see some things that I don't like and don't line up with your word. I need your help because I can't do it on my own. I can't change me. I can't do it. I need your help. This is a God thing. Instead, what do we get from most people in trouble? Excuses. I hear excuses every day. Well, I got this. Let me tell you, I'm only a drug addict because, my marriage is breaking up, but it's not really my fault. I mean, let me tell you what the real problem is, you know. I couldn't get to work on time. Let me tell you why. I hate excuses. I mean, anybody who knows me, just walk up and say, man, I messed up. I'll be like, me too. We're getting along. I can handle it. But when I hear, Well, you're not going to believe what happened. I just stopped him right there. You're right. I'm not, so let's not talk. Write it down. I ain't going to believe you. You know? Because we all got a million excuses. And we give God all these excuses. Who cares why you did it wrong? When you did it wrong, there's a penalty for doing it wrong. Life pays heavy penalties. You can say, well, I didn't mean. Oh, man. I'm going to leave this nameless. I don't think they're here, but I have an adopted son that I'm going to not tell you who his name is. And he got in a wreck. He ran into the back, and we still have this dilemma, but he ran into the back of a dump truck from Eggies. And I asked him. You got to understand, he's like a, you know, 17-year-old kid. Well, he had his license. He was about 30. No, I'm just teasing. Just teasing. At that time. And I said to him, I said, adopted son of mine that's nameless, Jared, I said, listen, I said, why'd you hit the truck? He goes, well, you know, it just happened. I said, it doesn't just happen. He said, well, I stopped in time. I said, what do you mean you stopped in time? Oh, I did. I stopped in time. How did you stop in time when you hit the truck? I don't know, but I stopped in time. To this day, I'm mad about that. I mean, what do you mean you stopped in time? He's like, well, I did. I said, you mean you stopped and they backed up and ran over you? He said, no. They just stopped faster, I guess. I don't know, but I stopped in time. What do you do with that? What God must think about us and our dumb excuses? Well, God, it's kind of your fault. God's like, what did I do? How many people blaming God? Man, don't blame God around me. If you ever done it, man. You know, Job laid it out pretty good. It's sin if you blame God for something. So then what does Moses do? He responds, here am I. Are you somebody who's willing to hear the Lord and then answer, respond to him? See, that's going to be what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to let him get our attention. Then he'll speak to us, but we're going to have to calm some stuff down where we can hear him. I'm telling you what, God doesn't speak over video games. I tried that. He doesn't speak over television. He doesn't speak over your wife. Those things are evil. I'm just teasing. I'm just teasing. I just wanted to make sure she was listening good. And let me tell you, I'm in trouble here now. No, they don't have to be evil. God's not going to speak over them. Not going to do it. He's not going to yell over your children. Some of you need to get a babysitter to hear from God. And I don't mean an excuse. You need to get a babysitter to hear from God. Because your kids are a nightmare. And they're just crazy, out of control. You need a babysitter to hear from God. I'm sorry. I love you, but it's true. You know it. I got to tell you, I'm going to put a conference on someday, okay? How to keep your church small. You know, I could do it. I could win that conference. You know, if you just offend everybody at all points every Sunday, eventually these people are going to quit coming back, you know? And if not, there's something wrong with them, you know? I'm telling you. I don't know. I could do that conference. I could even sell tapes, I think. Just don't know who wants to buy them, but I could do it. So now listen. Are you willing to live humbly before God? Listen to what he says in verse 5. Then he said, so here God says, here am I. And God says, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you're standing is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your fathers and the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Moses hid his face and was afraid to look upon God. Do you have any reverence for God? Because I want to tell you something. The American church that I see doesn't have any. I don't want to get back into legalism, but I want to tell you something. We live. We have sex with people that we're not married to. We live with people. We drink. We, you know, do dope. We excuse everything we do. We lie, steal, cheat. Corporate America acts like they're some Republican Christian. Whatever. I'm a Republican, don't get me wrong, but I didn't want anyone going, like, he's a Democrat. That'll really clear out my church. Got to keep a few of you in here. So, folks, here's the, it's fine. You can be a Democrat. I'll pray for you. So now listen, I told you I'm going after everyone today. So here's the deal, folks. Listen, we do all kinds of liberal, nasty, horrible things, ungodly things, and go, God, you have to forgive me. I had someone look me in the face this week and tell me that them having a relationship outside of marriage, having sex outside of marriage, was not sin. Wow. You know me, I just calmly said, well, I think you're wrong. And you just live with that. Be in peace, peace. You know, just let God love you, sweetheart. I said, man, you kidding? We all have trouble. We all have failures. We all go through difficulties. But there's something wrong inside, especially when we begin to say it's okay to sin. You know what? I've been through some things. It doesn't make it right. I'll be the first to tell you divorce is always 100% wrong in every case. That'll make some people mad. Well, but you don't know what was happening to me. It's wrong. It's wrong. It may not be your fault. Some of it was. Come on. Nobody's innocent. But you know what? It's always wrong. It's never God's best. Ever, 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 ever. I can't justify that. You can't. But folks, we don't even have a reverence or humility for God anymore. I'm not talking about living legalism. I hate legalism. But we got to start loving God. We've got to start respecting God. We've got to start going, God, you know what? This is your house. This is where we come together. And you know how we do that best? We start loving and honoring one another. When you start loving one another, God's just like, this is cool stuff. I like that. I mean, God likes it when we love each other, when we care about each other, but we live according to his word. He likes that. Why? You know, I had someone say to me, well, you know, I just don't think God sees the sin as so bad. You know what? Why does God see sin bad? Why is God thinking sin's bad? Because it separates you from him and it hurts and destroys your life. This isn't God over here going, well, I think that's bad, and that's not, well, but that could be bad. I'm going to make a bunch of rules. That isn't what it's about. God hates sin because it hurts you. God hates sin. Oh, man, I'm hurrying. Don't worry. I'm all the way to 4. There's 14, but I'm all the way to 4 points. Actually, I'm on the 5th right here. I will certainly be with you, he says. I am with you. That's what matters, folks, is that God is going to stay with us. He is going to be with us no matter what, but that shouldn't be a reason for us to break the heart of God. Who are you? Who are you is found deep inside. In verse 14 of this, of chapter 3 of Exodus, and God says to Moses, I am who I am. See, Moses had went up and he said, you know, when he hears from God, God says to him, you know, here's some things I want you to do. And Moses says, who am I? I can't speak right. You know, I don't have anything. I love this message. I preached it years ago. I don't have anything. What do I got? And God looks at him and goes, well, you got a stick right there in your hand. Oh. That was enough. See, with God, he doesn't want what you don't have. He just wants what you do have. He doesn't care about who you're going to be. He cares about who you are right now. He doesn't care about the job you're going to get. He just cares about where you're at right now. He'll direct all that stuff if you'll listen to him. If you'll let God change who you are on the inside, all the circumstances, they'll work out. You say, oh, pastor, come on. It's true. It's true. Is everything easy for me? Absolutely not. Doesn't change the fact God's always been faithful. Always, always, always. I can't lay anything at his feet. It'd be sin for me to try. Folks, what I have to do is look inside and realize that there's areas of my heart and my life that I have to expose to the presence of God and to the word of God and say, God, I want to be molded into who you are. And I have to do that not once a week, not now and then, every single day. I want to be led by the Holy Spirit. Are you willing to humble yourself? You'll never find God until you find yourself, because see, it goes on in 14 and it says, God says, I am who I say I am. What he means by that is he says, listen, I am eternal God. I am before you, I'm current, and I'll be after. I'm always going to be consistent. See, the thing about God is you can't tell me a lie about what God did, because God's always consistent. He's always been consistent. He's always been consistent for me. God's ultimate consistent. Folks, we're his children. We're supposed to respond to consistent parenting. But a rebellious child can't be parented without great discipline. And then we go, God, why are you doing this to me? He's disciplining you. Why? Because you're rebellious. Because you won't do what he said. You won't live like he wants you to. And guess what? It hurts. I mean, I remember what a rebellious child was like. I was one. It hurt my behind. It hurt my feelings. My son, it hurt my feelings, Daddy. Really? Wow. You shouldn't put your feelings on your behind. Because when I spank you, it's hurting your feelings. And he's just like, what? I like just to make fun of my kids sometimes. I'll tell you what. I'll keep your interest for like 2 more minutes. You ready for this? Song of Solomon. Thought that'd get you. Second. No, I can't go there yet. Man. All right, Song of Solomon. My beloved is mine, and I'm his. He feeds his flocks among the lilies. And then in Psalms, Song of Solomon 2:14, he says, he brought me to my banqueting, his banqueting table. His banner over me is love. Folks, I want to tell you something. We are called to be the lover of Jesus Christ. We're called to be, amen, we're called to be his bride. He's not interested in a casual relationship. He's wanting people who are kingdom builders and who are in his kingdom ruling with him right now. Not someday, now. He wants you to be his bride now. He wants intimate times with you. He wants a good relationship with you. Could you imagine if I'd have gotten married to Christy and then just been like, see ya? No, we build a relationship. What if we, maybe if I just visit once a month? No relationship, once a week? She wants a kiss in the morning. She wants a conversation. She wants to talk. She likes to fight. No, not really. But I will tell you this. If there's a disagreement, the lady, like, wants to talk it out. You know, I'm just like, sometimes you can't do that. You know? Here's the reality, folks. We have to have a relationship. Every day, we can't just give up, quit when times get tough. We've got to love each other. We've got to care about each other. We've got to talk to each other. And it isn't once in a while. It's all the time. It's putting into the relationship. When you have a disagreement, when you hurt, when it's easier to do everything else, folks. But what is it? What really matters? What's in here comes out. Now listen, in my relationship with my wife, what's in here will come out. Loving her, honoring her, taking care of her. What's in here will come out. If you're saying mean, nasty, horrible things, if you're neglecting your wife, men, the problem isn't what you're doing. The problem is what's in your heart. And you can keep saying, you know what I feel in my heart. Problem is what's in your heart. Ladies, the problem is what's in your heart. You got to fix what's in your heart. And you say, well, I just don't think we can work it out anymore. We fell out of love. No, you didn't. You walked out of love. You can walk yourself right back into love if you want. Change what's inside your heart. The problem is we get so hurt and so many wounds and so much neglect of our relationship that next thing you know, we don't think we can fix it. I want to tell you, too many of us are doing that with God, but it starts with what's inside. You see, what's the issue with your relationship is about what's in your heart. I'll read this last one, 2 Corinthians 5:14, and then we'll be done. For the love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and rose again. Verse 16, therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Did you hear me? We don't regard him according to the flesh. If you're born again of the Spirit of God, we don't regard you according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he's a new creation. The old things are gone and passed away. Behold, all things are brand new. Who am I? I am a brand new person in Christ Jesus. The old things are gone. Everything new has come. You know what I love about when someone comes and gives their heart to the Lord? They're getting a fresh, brand new start. Verse 18, now all things are of God, who are reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us a ministry of reconciliation. Folks, you're not just reconciled. You've been given a ministry. Whatever God's done for you, you're to do for others. He's reconciled you to himself. You need to reconcile the people you know to God. He's given you that ministry. But how does that ministry start? Listen to this. That is that God was in Christ, reconciled to the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. You want to know what you have to do? You have to get it in your mouth. You want to restore people? You have to start loving people. You have to start saying the right things, the good things to people. You can't just be down like I was all day just hammering you. No, you got to speak life and love, increase and truth. Why? Because folks, I want to tell you something. Everybody can feel bad about what they've done. That's not going to make you want to change inside. Jesus said, I didn't come into this world to condemn the world. The world was already condemned. I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly. Wrong is wrong, but folks, right is much better. We got to start living right, acting right, and telling people the right things, the word of truth. We must start speaking words of reconciliation. Today, you're going to have a choice. If you don't know Jesus, you're going to have an opportunity to know him. If you know him, after even this first service this morning, which I think I probably did a better job on, but across the front, people came and were giving their hearts to the Lord. There was people coming and dealing with some things that were deep. You know why? Because folks, it's not all the excuses and all the fruit and the stuff on the outside. It's what's inside. And see, I can't judge what's in your heart. I know your fruit. I can see that. The more I get to know you, the more I know your fruit. Do you know why most pastors don't want you to get very close to them? Because you'll see their fruit. And that fake fruit looks good from a distance. That's why you're all invited to my house tonight. Come see me. Come see where I live. I'm not joking. 6 o'clock. Or one of the other home groups. Because folks, you know what? I don't mean to hide. I'm not perfect. And neither are you. So let's serve God together. Let's see God do something amazing. Let's see God do something amazing. By beginning to not regard everyone this way and beginning to start letting God do something amazing in us deep inside. See, when things are good inside, you're not afraid what people see on the outside. but are things good on the inside? I want to simply ask this. If you do not know the Lord as your personal Lord and Savior, you can be His. The one who loves you enough to give His life. Not just gave His life. He gives His life for you. Because He's the same before, now, and in the future. He's consistent. We're not. And He loves us anyway. But He wants to bring us to a place of victory, a place of power. If you're here today and you do not know the Lord Jesus, and you'd like to, would you raise your hand so we can pray with you? I see that hand. Anyone else? Anyone else? Just say, Pastor, that's me. I want to give my heart to Jesus. I want to know Him. I want to know Him. Anyone else? Amen. I see that hand. Could I have some ladies come right here in the front? Just two or three of the staff ladies come right up front here. I want you to be able to pray for these ones that raised their hands. There were some ladies here that raised their hands. If there's anyone else who wants to know Christ, we want to be here for you. We want to pray for you. But you know what? As late as it is, I want every one of us to examine our own heart. Please close your eyes, bow your head. And be honest with yourself. Quit blaming everything and everyone. Where are you at really with God? Not what did you put on. Where are you really at with God? If you're not where you need to be right now to meet the challenges of every day that you're facing, if life is overwhelming for you, then there's more of God for you. Because He's more than enough for you. If you've got some things that are just not clicking right, let's quit trying to change all the outward stuff and let's start something inside. I'm going to ask you, if that's you, if you raised your hand or maybe you know that's you and you want to spend a few moments in prayer before you leave, these altars are open. Let people slide out from where they're at. If you raised your hand, this is a place of prayer. I'm going to dismiss you, but if you need to get on your face before God, this is that moment right now. If there's something inside of you and you say, God, I'm not where I need to be, then come on. Come on now. You can pray on your own. You can pray with somebody. It doesn't matter. If you know that you're not where you need to be, but you want to be where God has called you and He can love you and He can bless you and He can give you the life you've been looking for. I believe that. I know that. I live that. I've been on every side of that fence. God's best. Nothing else. Heavenly Father, I ask that, Lord, if there be anyone else, let them step out. Lord, even some who raised their hands haven't come. But Lord, I know You're faithful. Lord, we've examined our hearts today and we've not always found what we like. But Lord, in You we find great things. Lord, we open up our hearts for You to be great in us. Show us who we are, Lord. And let us be more like You. Help us, God. We don't do it on our own. We can't do it. Help us, Lord. That our fruit will begin to change. And our good fruit will remain and lives will be changed. Generations to come that will begin to live out the kingdom of God and find increase. In Jesus' name, Lord, go with each and every one that needs to go. Amen.
Crossfire. It's more than a TV show. Hello, my name is Pastor Dave Spear. At Crossfire, our vision is to reach out and minister to folks just like you in a hurting and dying world, in both conventional and unconventional ways. We want to see young people and adults come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, ministering first to those in our community, then to our state, our country, and to the entire world. Our mission is to evangelize those who don't know Christ, equip those who do, and to exalt God who is alive and worthy of all honor, praise, and glory. We would love to invite you to Crossfire Sunday morning, 9:30. Pastor Aaron preaches a great word. At 10:30, we have incredible life-changing worship. 11:30, Pastor Aaron will preach. We really would love to see you here Sunday morning. From our family to yours, God bless you.
I hope you enjoyed today's message, and my heart is always that it touches your life, that the message somehow God is able to speak to you individually. Not so much that my words rang true, but that there's something deep inside of you that the Creator, the one who loves you so much, is able to speak into you and call you by name, speak into your life, that you would find out who you are in Christ. That is my heart. I hope it is right now that God is moving on your heart. And each and every one of us have the ability to just simply call out to God individually. If you'd like to pray with someone, if you'd like to ask some any questions, there are people that are standing by, would love to call, have you call them, love to talk with you. They would love to see God do something amazing in your life right now. We would love to have you contact us, call us. We'd love to pray with you. You can call us at 541-686-3473. That's 541-686-3473-686-FIRE. And I know that God is wanting to touch your life. I know people will do our best to answer the phones within 1 hour. If you'll leave a message, if somehow you don't get through, we'll call you back. We'd love to pray with you and talk with you. I know God is doing great things. If you'd like to know more about the church, or would like to write us, or go onto our website, all that information's on the screen. And I really encourage you to continue with what God has begun today in your life and in your heart. This is Pastor Aaron. We'll see you next week on Crossfire Television, a program that changes lives because of the power of God.
1 John chapter 5 says that those who believe in Christ have a testimony of Him in their heart. We want to know what God is doing in your life. Leave an audio testimony by calling the number at the bottom of the screen. You can also send a 3 to 5 minute video testimony to the address at the bottom of the screen. Don't forget to share your testimony by clicking on the testimony section of our website. We want to post your testimony online in an update or on our television program. Every changed life and daily miracle deserves a testimony. Help us spread the gospel by sharing what God is doing in your life.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today to make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477.